I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven come to fight for me. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm, louder and louder. You're gonna hear my praises roar up from the ashes. Hope will arise. Death is defeated. The King is alive. Watch the darkness flee. I raise a hallelujah in the middle of the mystery. I raise a hallelujah. You lost your hold on me. The storm louder and louder. You're gonna hear my praises roar up from the ashes. Hope will arise. Death is defeated. The King is alive. Sing a little louder in the presence of my louder than the unbelief. Sing a little louder. My weapon is a melody. Sing a little louder. Heaven comes to fight for me. Sing a little louder in the presence of my enemies. Sing a little louder. Louder than the unbelief. Storm louder and louder. You're gonna hear my praises roar up from the ashes. Hope will arise. Death is defeated. The King is alive. Every new day, your glory unfolds. treasures unto the beauty of holiness brings worship anew. My greatest love is you. Every new day, your glory unfolds, filling my eyes with your treasures unto. Beauty of holiness brings worship anew. My greatest love is you. Call me deeper into your grace. The river that flows from the holy place. Wash over me. Treasures unto the beauty of holiness brings worship anew. My greatest love is you. Call me deeper into your grace. The river that flows from the glory unfolds, filling my eyes with your treasures unto. The beauty of holiness brings worship anew. My greatest love is you. My greatest love.
Brothers and sisters in the Lord, shalom and good morning. The last time we joined Solomon in Ecclesiastes, we were at chapter 2. And chapter 2 was really Solomon trying to experiment and trying to make surveys of what is his thoughts in chapter 1. And what was in chapter 1? Chapter 1 was his thoughts as to what if life has no God. There's no God in the sums of human life. If the divine was not involved, what does life mean? And he came to the conclusion that life is meaningless. Labor is meaningless because there is no purpose. Someone used the analogy of life without God or life without the divine as a soap bubble life. Now, soap bubbles are pretty nice after you have blown them. They're colorful. They float out into the air. But after a while, it loses tension and then it bursts and there's nothing. And so for a moment, maybe life is like that, after it bursts, there is nothing. But when we come to chapter 3 and into chapter 4, and particularly chapter 3, we see maybe there is a little bit of change, a slight change, because Solomon is nudging towards a point where he says, could there possibly be a God? And if there is a God, if there is divine involvement, how is he involved in the life of man? How is he involved in the sum of all things on this earth? Now, you must understand that as Solomon looks at this, he is going to go like a pendulum. He's going to go one end to the other, because on one end, he will say that there is a God. And then if he comes to the middle, maybe there is a God, but there's always a but. And then on the other side is, there is no God, things are meaningless. And throughout chapter 3 and even chapter 4, he's going to do this swing up and down. And that is why, let me say that reading through chapter 3 and chapter 4 is quite a hurdle for many of us. And so today, for us to really understand chapter 3 and 4, let us really seek divine help. Let us ask the Holy Spirit to teach us and to guide us. Let us pray. Father, thank you this morning for the privilege of coming together to worship you, to listen to your word, even if we are still online on the internet. Father, we thank you that although we yearn to be back together, you have provided for us a space, a time, a way to have our hearts still sewn together in your name. As we come to listen and to understand what Solomon has written in Ecclesiastes 3, Lord, we pray. And in 4, we pray, God, the Holy Spirit, just teach us. The Supreme Teacher, just teach us and open up our eyes to understand, to see what Solomon is coming to the conclusions, and maybe some of these conclusions will also be ours. Be with us, O Lord, and bless us this day. In Jesus' name we pray. If you have your Bibles with you, turn with me to Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and let us read. And as we read along, we are going to pick up the lessons from there. Verse 1, there is a time for everything, a season for every activity under heaven. Now remember, just now I said that Solomon is slowly nudging to another area, a point. Maybe there is a God involved in all of these things on earth, involved in the lives of men on earth. And that is why he says under heaven. It's above the sun, isn't it? Closer to God. And he goes into from verse 2 to verse 8. And these verses, these few verses are quite popular with pastors, and I'll tell you why later. Okay, and let's hear what it says. It says, a time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant, a time to uproot, a time to kill, a time to heal, a time to tear down, and a time to build up, a time to weep, and a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance. And I hope that RCC, we dance to the Lord. A time to scatter stones, and a time to gather them, a time to embrace, a time to refrain from embracing, a time to search, a time to give up, a time to keep, a time to throw away. Yes, there is a time to throw away things. My brothers and sisters, don't be hoarders. A time to tear, a time to mend, a time to be silent, a time to speak, a time to love, and a time to hate, a time for war, and a time for peace. Now, I say this, it is a very interesting few verses, because pastors like myself, I've done it before, that we use this and we preach on this concerning the importance of time, the value of time. And I think it is not wrong. However, the question about it is that what context was Solomon writing? Now, those of you who are grew up in the 60s, now this sounds a little bit familiar, doesn't it? You know, and if you know this, there is a song written by Peter Seeger and sung by the Birds.
And their time to every purpose under heaven. A time of love, a time of hate, a time of...
Okay, I'm going to stop there because a few weeks back I played something with Mick Jagger, and now I play something from the Birds. I think, I hope you don't think that I am one of those guys who are hippie and all that and listen to all these kind of songs. The thing about it was, I was too young. Somehow or other, along the way, I heard these songs and then But, you know, friends, these songs, those days, seem to come from the Bible. And sometimes I just feel that even better than some of our Christian singers, Christian writers today, because they don't seem to write anything from the Bible, just by a lot of feelings. Oh, I'm sorry, I've taken us away from what is really Solomon saying. But let's take a look at the birds. As they sang, you look at them, it was melodic, the people were dancing, and there was so much happiness, you know. But was it truly happiness? Because at least one of the singers ended up losing his mind. We all know that all of them were into drugs. All of them were into alcohol and smoking and all that. Was it a message that was an anthem of great fun and of victory? Or was it an anthem of pain and despair? Was there truth for them? What is the truth here? Or what is the context that Solomon was writing concerning this part of Ecclesiastes 3? As he looked at the time and seasons, what was he trying to tell us? To know that, we need to see verse 9. And what does verse 9 say? Verse 9 says this: what does the worker gain from his toil? Now you hear all this about time and season, and suddenly there are events in the season, but suddenly he says this in verse 9: what does the worker gain from his toil? You can suddenly hear as though it is something very painful, something very negative. He starts saying this. You know, there's season for things, there are time for events to take place. But what's the point? At the end of the day, what's the point? It is a big waste of time. We gain nothing, not even in our work. And in verse 10, it says that, I have seen the burden that God has laid on the human race. He looks at even work as a burden from God to the human race. Now that is his context. When he looks at the world and whatever is happening in the world, the seasons, the time, the events, the work, and he says that, what's the point? Because at the end of the day, it is a burden from God. Now, you must understand that Solomon is looking still at this point in time, the pendulum at the end, that there is no God and life is meaningless. Because he can't figure out who God is. Now, for you and I who are believers, one of the things that God reminds us again and again is that there is importance in work. Jesus talked about what? The master going away, and he makes sure that the talents are being used, the workers used for the advancement, the increase of whatever talents there. There's work to be done. In fact, Paul writes in two parts of the Bible about the issue of work. The first one is found in 1 Timothy. And when he tells Timothy to say, and he says in 1 Timothy 5, that the person who doesn't work to look after his family is an infidel. He is not even a believer. You know how strong it is? He equates believing in Jesus Christ, being a believer, to work. Because work is important. Work keeps us connected to God. Isn't it true that God, when he created us, he created Adam, and he told Adam, now this is the earth, now you have a dominion, you are supposed to look after the earth. That is work to be done, to look after the earth. And then in Thessalonians, 2 Thessalonians, he tells the Thessalonians that, very simple, the church there, this is very simple, he who does not work does not eat. If you don't work, if you are trying to find a job and you can't find a job and you need someone to give you the charity, fine. But if you are able and capable and there are available jobs, so if you refuse, you just want to be a couch potato, you who do not work do not eat. So work is important for a Christian context. But here Solomon says that he doesn't see, he sees it as a burden, he sees it that work is burdensome. You know, I think if he's able to see that God is the one who gives us gifts of our skills, our knowledge, our ability, our talents, those must be employed into work, and there is blessing in our work. Nonetheless, he turns to something very interesting in verse 11, and a lot of us love this verse. It says that God has made everything beautiful in his time. Some of us remember in the 80s, we used to sing this song, in his time, he makes all things beautiful in his time. You know, oh, so sweet, so beautiful. But what is Solomon writing here? He says that God has made everything beautiful in his time. That's the truth. See, now it swings that there is a God and he makes things beautiful in his time. Now, the NASB, the New American Standard Version, instead of using the word beautiful, he says appropriate. It says appropriate. So God, in his time, makes everything appropriate for us, for the world, for this earth. And there's a second truth also in the following line. He says that he has also set eternity in the human heart. And that's true. You know, Blaise Pascal says that there is a God-shaped vacuum in our hearts that we yearn for God. God, we yearn for the eternity. We yearn for who he is. And then Solomon switches to something again on the other side. It's really a pendulum because he says, yes, God makes everything beautiful in his time. God is a yearning for eternity in man's heart. And he says, the next line, he says, yet no one can fathom what God has done from the beginning to the end. You know, he's saying this, yes, God is the one who makes things beautiful. And then he's the one who set eternity in our hearts. Then he comes to the middle again. This is where he says, there is a God, but, you know, but who can figure out what all of this is? Who can figure out God, you know? And he swings back again in despair. And you can see now, he goes up and down, back and forth. And he continues and says, I know there is nothing better for people than to be happy and to do good. I'm going to just continue to read while they live, that each of them may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all their toil. This is a gift of God. And you know, Solomon doesn't realize he's coming so close to the truth. Yes, God is eternal. Yes, God is the only wise God. He will in his time make things beautiful, all things beautiful. He has set eternity in the hearts of men. He wants us to be joyous and to do the good things here on earth. He wants us to eat and drink. In fact, the Chinese has a proverb that the ability to eat is a blessing. God sets this for us. But Solomon looks at it the other way around. Since he can't figure God out, at the end of the day, he says, let's eat, drink, and the phrase there, be satisfied, find satisfaction in our toil, is to say, let's reward ourselves for all that we labor. And again, God is not in that picture again. But friends, God's kingdom is not about meat or drink. God's kingdom is about righteousness and peace and joy and in the Holy Spirit who dwells with us and in us and over us. That is God's kingdom. Now can you see when the context that Solomon looks at is about himself, is about the life here, is about without God, a world and a time without God, it is meaningless. But in the context, the believer can see it is absolutely different. It is such a blessing that God has given to us. And in verse 14, it says, I know that everything God does will endure forever. Nothing can be added to it. Nothing can be taken for it. And how much truth there is that God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And that God will be the one who ensures that, you know, friends, it is such a beautiful line of truth there. Because God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And whatever he has done, whatever he commands to be done, is done. that I am assured of my salvation in Christ Jesus. Because God never changes. God never changes. Solomon continues writing, God does all of this so that people will fear him. And the word fear there, where Solomon writes, is a dreaded fear. And in the context, he's a fatalist. One who says, everything is terrible, everything is God is in control of everything, I don't have to do anything, woe is to me, and that's it. You know? And that's life. But I believe God wants us not to fear him as that dreaded fear. God wants us to, do you remember I shared with us in church once, that God wants us to fear him, that reverent fear, to say that you are God and we want to approach you rather than run away from him, to be drawn to him, to be drawn to his love, to be drawn to who he is, so that we are also then therefore made perfect in him by Christ Jesus. You know, God wants us to please him, for reverence, for respect, for honor. And because of that, because God never changes who he is, I am very confident. You know, turn with me to Romans chapter 8. And in Romans chapter 8, verse 38, and it says here, you know, Paul writes to the Roman church, he says, for I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present, the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. You see, if I am so confident that God never changes, and what he says is yea and amen, then my confidence is in him through Christ Jesus, that nothing can separate me from him. But Solomon is different. He looks and says, we fear God, you know, and this is our portion. And as he goes down the line, he says that, you know, because I don't understand God, you know, I couldn't have a full understanding. I have only limited understanding of him. You know, friends, when do we have a limited understanding of God? When we are disconnected from God. When we are disconnected from him, we are disillusioned in life. And here Solomon is beginning to show us that he's disillusioned in life. And he says, you know, I don't understand God and all of these things. I fear him now. And what do I fear him about? Verse 15 tells us, whatever has already been and what will be has been before, and God will call the past to account. A mouthful, isn't that? But what is Solomon trying to write here? He's saying the past, the present, the future is bound in God, and God is in control. And there's so much truth to this. But for a fatalist, he sees as God is in control. What can I do? Que sera, sera. And whatever will be, will be. So he falls into this depression. And he says, now he begins to see and say this. He says, verse 16, I saw something else under the sun. Again, going back to a place where there is no God. Okay? That in the place of judgment, there is wickedness there. In the place of justice, wickedness was there. You know, he says that even in the place where there should be righteousness, there should be a fair deal, wickedness still exists. People are wicked. You know, even the judges, what he's trying to say is that even the judges are wicked, even the judges are corrupted. And he says, where then is God? And seriously, what happens is, in the next verse, in verse 17, he says this, well, I believe that God is in existence, he is in control, he will bring into judgment both the righteous and the wicked, for there will be a time for every activity, a time to be judged, to judge every deed. And he is right. Again, he swings to the side. There isn't God who's going to do all that. But there's a half-truth. Firstly, the truth. The truth is that God will judge. There is a God who will judge. But there is an untruth here also, or not a very accurate thing. Because the righteous, as according to the Bible, the righteous will in Christ Jesus will not be judged. The second coming of Jesus Christ is a jubilation for the righteous in his name. Romans 8:1. Therefore, there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. There is no condemnation. So there is judgment for those who are wicked. So now can you see, my dear friends, Solomon now goes swing back and forth because he has no context of God. He has no clear understanding of who God is. He goes from a point where there is no God and things are meaningless, and then there is a God and he is like that, and but perhaps there is a God, but, and he goes up and down. He speaks some truth, and yet about God and about how God deals with the earth and deals with man, and yet he comes to another point where he is not sure, and he is such a confused person. And he gets depressed. Now, if everyone is to be judged, this is a very depressing view by the fatalist. So he says to himself in verse 18, he says, I also said to myself, as for humans, God tests them so that they may see that they are like the animals. Oh my goodness, he is beginning to see us as animals or himself, because he sees how God tries us, how God tests men, how God treats men. So now you understand his view about God. Now that God, who is that one who makes things beautiful, comes to a point where God is the dreaded God. Surely the fate of human beings is like that of the animals. Same fate awaits them both. As one dies, so dies the other. All have the same breath. Humans have no advantage over the animals. Everything is meaningless. Can you hear how he's come to a point where he looks at all of this, now he swings back to the meaninglessness? You know, Solomon himself in his eyes had brought himself so low that he equates men as animals. And it is a view that there is without God in existence, without the context of God. Just in case we think that this view is atrocious or this view is ridiculous, let me tell you that this view is very much alive today. It is a worldview that's very much alive. There is care in many places, and sometimes even in Singapore, there's a care more for animals than for human beings, for people. There is more concern about saving whales than saving unborn babies. It is okay to go ahead with abortion in the third trimester. They're not humans anyway. But this is where we are. And all of these, as is taught to our children in schools, evolution and all that, that equates man, that you came from an ape, and equates man to animals. Now friends, no wonder we are all, or the people, many people are beginning to behave like animals. Take a look at all the riots, take a look at the rebellion. And for some of us, take a look at the rebellion in the household. We are becoming like animals because someone begins to say that we are equal to the animals. Solomon has only one thing in his mind when he said this. He says, we live like the dog, we die like the dog. But the biblical view, my friends, you and I, we know, is different. When God created Adam, he says, you have dominion over the animals. You have dominion. In other words, you have to have dominion. You have to be above. We are above the animals. We rule over the animals. And we are different because we are made in the image. We are the only ones made in the image of God. With a conscience, with a soul and a spirit, a sense of right and wrong, we are so treasured by God that God sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die for you and I. He didn't come to die for the animals. He came to die for you and I. And so, my friends, this is where Solomon misses it out. Because he says the human life is nothing. God says all human lives matters. All human life matters. And he continues to say, oh, all of us go to the same place. we all come from dust, and to dust all of us return again. He's correct, because all of us will die. But the next point, to verse 21, he says, who knows if the human spirit rises upward and if the spirit of the animal goes down into the earth? You know, this is where he is wrong. He's absolutely wrong. Because in John 14, what did Jesus tell his disciples, and with that tells us that he goes, and for us who believe in him, he goes and prepare a room in the Father's house for us. We will be with him in the heavenlies if we put our trust in him, if we surrender our lives to him. You know, friends, the moment you take the context away from God, the very same thing that is said has a different meaning altogether. Solomon has a context about life just here without God, and therefore it is meaningless. And in verse 22, so he says, so I saw there was nothing better for a man than to enjoy his work, because this is their lot, for who can bring them to see what will happen after them? He says that we don't know whether there's heaven or there is not. I'm going to stop here for a while. I'm going to stop it for a while to say this, my brothers and sisters, and for those of you who are listening to my voice. You know how we believe that there is a heaven? Do you know how I believe that Jesus has gone forth ahead to prepare a room for me? You see, if you look all the way in the Bible from Genesis all the way down to Revelation, or just all the way to the time when Jesus came, the first time he came, a Christmas as we call it. Prophecy after prophecy has been fulfilled in the life of Jesus. And sometimes, even if you look beyond that, prophecy after prophecies, there are so many prophecies in the Bible, and yet, my friends, more than 85% have been fulfilled. There's another 15%, not yet. The 15%, when it is fulfilled, Jesus Christ will come again. So, how do I believe? I look at what has transpired as promised. And so I sit here looking at what Solomon is writing, and he says, I don't know and I don't understand, you know, and I don't see what's going to happen to me, because he has not put God into the context. He has not seen it from God's point of view. You and I have the opportunity now. You and I can see what God has done, what God is doing, and what he is going to do. And so, friends, even as we follow Solomon and into chapter 4, because now he goes back into his depressive state. He goes back to a point where, after all of the thinking through in chapter 3, he goes back to the point of meaninglessness, because there's nothing. So what does he do in verse 1 of chapter 4? He says, and I look, and again I look and I saw all the oppression that's taking place under the sun. See, going back to the word under the sun, that is his context. He swings back to the other end. And he says, I saw tears of the oppressed, and they have no comforter. Poor, the powers on the side of the oppressor, and they have no comforter. I declare that the dead who had already died are happier than the living. You know, he's saying that the dead is better than the living, who are still alive. But better than both is one who has never ever been born, who has not seen the evil that is done under the sun. This is depressing, isn't it? The fatalist view of the world. The world is so evil, better not to be born. No, if I were born, those who have died are better than us. What a depressing view, isn't it? You know, I know of young married couples who do not want to have children, to be born in this bad world. But the point is this, listen, the point is this. The world in its whole history has always had instances of bad things. World War I, let's take it closer. World War I, 20 million people died. World War II, 80 million people died, including the Holocaust. And then this the nuclear bomb threat in the Cold War. And yet over all of this time, babies are still birthed into this world. In fact, the world has increased exponentially ever since World War I. People are still giving birth. I mean, let's put it this way. Can you imagine someone telling you as you are driving, oh, there was an accident there yesterday. Shall we not use that same road again? Just because there was an accident, we shall not use the road. Just because there's something bad, we shall not do this. If you and I follow what is God's command, what is God's command? Go forth and multiply and fill the earth. And if you and I are Christians and we believe in God, then can we trust Him as we bring children into this earth because it is what He wants us to do? Then can we trust Him that He will look after the children? He will use us, He will use others to bring up children. He will send the Holy Spirit to guide the children. He will show the children that Jesus is the Lord, the Savior. Can we trust Him? You see, friends, we all say that we are Christians, and we all say that when we die, we will go to the heavens, and we will be in the one of the rooms that Jesus has promised in the mansion of the Father. We have not seen that. But can I say that let's learn to trust the Lord here so that when we come to that point when we are crossing over, we can continue to trust Him. We already know how to trust Him. Can we do that, my dear friends? So can we trust that when the Lord says, two shall become one, and then you have children, let us say, Lord, we want to have children. But you watch over this child, watch over our children, and bless them. And just obey the Lord. And let's not be like Solomon who goes into this despair. And he says this in verse 4, he says, I saw that all the toil and all achievements springing from the person's envy of another. This too is meaningless, chasing after the wind. Why do you want to do? Why are you envious of something that somebody else has, and you run after that? It's meaningless, because at the end, it's really soap bubble, isn't it? And at the other side, he says that, what about those who are fools, who don't want to do anything, and just fold their arms and ruin themselves? In the King James Version, it says that you gnaw and you eat yourself, you know? The Hokkien phrase, chakaki, you know, it was written there. But I think what Solomon is trying to say is this, that if you fold your hands and do nothing, you ruin yourself, you starve yourself. And so in verse 6, it's better one handful with tranquility than two handful with toil. But all of this is still chasing after the wind. What is he saying here in all of these two verses? Whether you work, whether you're envious, and then you gain or don't gain and do nothing, it is still meaningless. And I like verse 7 onwards. You know, friends, picture with me Solomon having all of these thoughts in chapter 3 and 4, all of his thoughts now. I'm trying to picture Solomon, you know, in the night he is unable to sleep. He wakes up, he walks to his balcony, and there's the moon there, and he looks across, and that's Jerusalem. And he's thinking to himself, he says, again, I saw the meaninglessness of things under the sun. In verse 8, he says this, there was a man all alone. He has neither son nor brother. There is no end to his toil, yet his eyes are not content with his wealth. For whom am I toiling, he said, and why am I depriving myself of enjoyment? This too is meaningless, a miserable business. You know, I sense when Solomon wrote this verse, he was very lonely. And you think about it, Solomon, 700 wives, 300 concubines, must have numerous children, half brothers, half sisters. He was popular, he was famous, people were coming over from other countries to listen to him, he was rich. And yet you can hear that tone of loneliness. And this loneliness, let me just coin it, loneliness in the midst of a crowd. And this happens to a lot of people who do not have God as their context. There are many famous people in the United States, in the acting, in the show business, who have a lot of suicide tendencies, who have suicide tendencies, and many of them have taken their lives, one after another. You know? And perhaps Solomon was standing there and says, in all of these things, I wish I had someone that who would journey with me, someone who would spar with me even mentally, think through this with me. You know, someone said about Mr. Lee Kuan Yew that very few people dare to really eyeball to talk to him because he's such a brilliant man, such a wise man. And perhaps this is Solomon too. When nobody wanted to talk to him, they were so afraid of, if I were to say this, what would his reply be, you know? And they find it so difficult to be on par or spar with him. And so he comes to verse 9 and 10. Onwards, he says, two are better than one because they have good return for their labor. If either of them falls down, one can help the other up. But pity anyone who falls and has no one to help them up. He goes into verse 11 and says, also, if two lie down together, they will keep warm. But how can one keep warm alone? Though one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves. A cord of three strands is not quickly broken. What is our dear Solomon saying here? He is saying something very simple. Following verse 8, as he says, I wish someone could be with me to listen to me, to spar with me, to figure out life with me, and to look at what truly works in life. And as he says, you know, three is better than one. Perhaps three is better because they check on each other. They affirm one another. You know, Alcoholic Anonymous, that group that helps people to, the program that helps people to get away from alcohol addiction. They do have this threesome, three persons coming together just to be the ones who, if you are craving for alcohol, you just call one of them or two of them and then they'll talk you out of it. And perhaps he, Solomon, was hoping that someone would help him to figure things out, to bring him to a point which we will find in Ecclesiastes 5. And that will be our next exploration. Today, we won't talk about Ecclesiastes 5. But there is something that he wants to help take him to Ecclesiastes 5. And so, friends, what is his in his mind? Let me have someone. Let me hopefully have someone. And then he goes on to something very interesting, because in his heart, in his mind, he realized perhaps there could not be anyone. And so he moves into verse 13. And let me read from verse 13 to the end of chapter 4. Better a poor but wise youth than an old but foolish king who no longer knows how to take warning. The youth may have come from prison to the kingship, or he may have been born in poverty within his kingdom. I saw that all who lived and walked under the sun followed the youth and the king's successor. There is no end to all the people who were before them, but those who came later were not pleased with the successor. This too is meaningless, chasing after the wind. What is he saying? He's saying that, you know, at the end of the day, well, one king will come after another. No matter what status the king comes in, or this person comes to take over the throne, there is this thing about pride and this thing about popularity. That popularity and position is fickle. You know, it will not last for long because it too will lose its glamour and become meaningless. You know, friends, as we come and close in our examination of chapter 3 and 4, I want to say this to all of us. I believe many of us today are like Solomon. We are in a place where we have negative, or if not negative, at least a confused view of who God is. Some of us are afraid of God because God is mad with me. Some of us are saying that, you know, I've done so much grievous thing that I don't think God can ever forgive me. Some of us look at ourselves and say we are not good enough for all that we have done. You know, friends, I have good news for you. And the good news is this, in the context, to have a meaningful life, to have a life that has purpose, and to have a life that, you know, that Solomon yearns for, is to be connected to God. All of Solomon's questions, all of Solomon's problems can be found in one answer or one person, and his person is Jesus Christ himself. Jesus Christ is the answer because in God's story for man and the earth, you know, Solomon was saying, we don't know, he doesn't understand, and don't know what is the beginning and the end of this earth and beginning and the end of man. But if you look at Genesis, from Genesis, you know, Jesus was there. Jesus is a creator. John's Gospel, chapter 1, verse 1. The Word was with God. The Word is creator himself. And the Word is God. Jesus is God. In Genesis, also, when man fell, what did God do? God already said in the sign that, you know, to the serpent, you know, the offspring of the woman will crush your head. There is victory in Jesus. God has already from the very beginning prepared Jesus Christ to come for this earth. And Jesus will be the King and the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He will be one, the one enthroned at the end. So the beginning and the end is answered in Jesus Christ himself. Jesus is the third strand of that three-strand cord. If life has Jesus Christ in the middle, you know, sometimes we share this during premarital counseling. We say that, you know, Jesus has to be your that middle strand where the two of you entwine to. And it's very interesting because in the old days, the people will use a middle cord, a middle strand, and have the other two strings entwined. And as the thing pulls, anything pulls at the two end, the stronger it pulls, the stronger the cord becomes. A cord of three strands is really not quickly broken. If Jesus is the center of it all, then nothing can be broken. If you can entrust him, you believe in him, obey him, trust him. In chapter 4, verse 1, Solomon repeats twice, there is no comforter for those who are oppressed. But Jesus says in John 14, that I go so that you will have a comforter. He will send a comforter, and he has sent the comforter, the Holy Spirit, to us. You know, friends, the Holy Spirit is with us. He journeys with us. The Holy Spirit is over us. He watches over us. The Holy Spirit is in us. He teaches us and he guides us. He gives us peace and comfort. And in verse 3, in chapter 3, verse 21, he says that, you know, where are we going? And remember what I say. Jesus says, I go ahead of you to prepare a place for you in my Father's mansion. And when Solomon was talking about judgment, yes, there will be judgment. Jesus is the judge, but Jesus is also the prize that God gave us, God sent to us to make us righteous in him. My friends, he is the payment for your sin and for my sin, paid by him. Nothing can separate us from that. For as far as the east is from the west, God has taken your sins, your transgression from you because of Jesus Christ. If you trust in him, if you believe in him, if you surrender yourself to him, my friends, Jesus is the answer. Jesus is the answer. Jesus, the nails on his hands and his feet, the spear in his side, the cross, my friends, is enough. God says, it's enough. Jesus declares that it is finished. Today, if you are a Christian and you find it so difficult to live your life, let me just say this to you. Begin to learn to trust Jesus, trust God. Come and abide with him. And let his word abide in you. dwell into His Word. Let the Holy Spirit who is in you guide you. And say to the Lord, Lord, I surrender. I can't surrender everything today because, you know, it is difficult, but help me to surrender one after another to you so that my life can be perfected by the Spirit working in me. For those of us who have yet to know Jesus Christ, and you are like Solomon, sometimes you have very negative thoughts about God, or sometimes you're confused, and you say that, you know, there is a God, but it's like this. Let me ask you to do one thing. Let me ask you to give yourself an opportunity to get to know Jesus Christ, an opportunity to say, yeah, my life is like that. And with or without God, it's still like that. Let me ask you to give yourself an opportunity. The opportunity to say, Jesus, come into my life. Let me trust you. And let me, you know, all the answers, questions that Solomon has, if it is found in you, then they are the same questions that I have. Give me your answers. I want you to come to Jesus and let Jesus begin to show you who He is. Shall we all close our eyes wherever we are? I want to pray with you and for you. Let us pray. For those of us who profess to be Christian and we find it so difficult to trust in God, right now, I want you to put your hand, your right hand, onto your heart, to your chest, and I want you to pray this alongside with me. Jesus, I have called you my Lord and my Savior, but somehow I don't know how to trust you fully, completely. I pray you teach me day by day from now onwards. I surrender my life to you. But each day, Lord, begin to take parts out of me which are not pleasing to you or to the Father, and renew my life in you, moment by moment, day by day. Help me to learn how to take my cross daily and follow you, and to trust in you, and to trust in all that you tell me to do. In Jesus' name, your name I pray. Amen. Now friends, for those of you who have so many questions and you are like Solomon, your problems one after another, I would like you to just close your eyes and you pray after me. Shall we do that? Jesus, the Bible says that you are God, but the Bible also says that you are the answer for every of Solomon's question, which are also my question. I ask you to come and show me the answer. Show me that you are the answer. This day, I give myself open my heart to you so that you can come and reveal yourself to me. For some of you, you want to say, Jesus, today I want to give my life to you. Today I want to receive you into my life as Lord and Savior. Repeat this after me. God, thank you for your love for me because Jesus was sent by you to die for me. Today, I want to come and call you Father because the Bible says I can call you Father. But to do so, I know I need to give myself to you. I repent of all my sins against you. The things I've done, which you know,
and the things that I've done which I always feel are too grievous, that I'm not good enough for you. But if the Bible is clear, Jesus is the answer for all of this. I repent of my sins. And Jesus, I believe in you. I believe that you are my Savior. And today I ask you to be my Lord. I ask you to send your Holy Spirit, whom I receive into my life. And I want to say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, in your name.
Thank you for that prayer. The Lord hears it, the Lord knows it, the Lord receives you as His child. The Lord, for the other ones, the Lord bless you. As you seek after Him, you will know Him. Because the Bible says, if you seek after God with all of your heart, He will reveal Himself to you. And for those of us who are Christians, let us continue to trust in the Lord and grow in Him, and to be like Christ Jesus. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you, be gracious to you. And the Lord lift up His countenance upon you and give you His peace.